come to you today, Lord, we thank you that we have an opportunity and a privilege to be able to read your word and to be able to study your word today. Lord, it's not something we want to take for granted, but God, we want to thank you every opportunity that we have the chance. So Lord, we want to do that today. God, I would pray that you would forgive me of the sin that is in my life and just place it beneath the blood of Jesus. Lord, I would also ask that you would help us today as we study from your word, this Old Testament passage, God, that you would use it to speak truth to our life and that we would be able to apply it to our life and, Lord, that we would be different as a result of it. God, it's always our prayer and it's our desire that you are honored and that you are glorified in everything that is said and that is done here today. Lord, we have so many different needs that we have today and in our church. And so, God, we are just trusting and we are praying that you can meet each and every one of those needs. Lord, speak to us in a way that only you can. Help us today, God, to just have a desire and a passion, not only to hear your word, but, Lord, to be able to live it as well. We love you and we thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to be seated. I'll leave your Bible open, if you would, to this Nehemiah passage, Nehemiah chapter 4. Now, we've been going chapter by chapter through the book of Nehemiah. Today, specifically, we're going to talk about a subject that I really honestly believe all of you relate to. Now, I probably say that a lot, but the truth of the matter is, this subject today is something that every single person here can relate to. So I'm going to begin with a question. I need you to pay attention. I need you to listen to this. I need you to write this question down and then answer it honestly. How is it that you respond to criticism? Let's think that through. How do you, as a Christian, respond to criticism? All of us face it. It's something we all have to deal with. And in fact, we have two groups of people here today. We have the groups of individuals that are sitting here that are receiving criticism from others. That could be folks you work with. It could be your family. It can even be friends. And then we have individuals sitting here today, and you are the givers of criticism. Well, the givers of criticism, that's a whole nother lesson for another time. Today, however, we are going to talk about those of us that experience criticism. An important question we have to ask is this. Are there any biblical examples in the Bible of how to handle criticism? If we know it's something we're going to face, does the Bible tell us how to face this? Well, the answer to that question on the short end of it is yes. But let me just be transparent and start this message off by saying this. We probably all fell to the test of criticism, but you are looking at a man that does not like to be criticized. Mm-hmm. I am telling you, I'm just being transparent, and this is a weakness of mine, it's a shortcoming of mine, but there is nothing that will get my blood pressure up more, or I could say nothing that would make me react more than when someone criticizes me. I'm not talking about preaching. I've got used to that over the years. I don't know how to deal with that. But I'm talking about as a person, as an individual, as a human being. When someone criticizes me, immediately I go on the defense. And I want to attack, and I want to get even, and I want to get back. Now, you may judge me for that, and that's okay, but can any of you relate to that? Criticism does that to you. You're attacked, and as a result of that, you want to get even. You want to point out the faults of the person that is criticizing you. You also probably fail the test of criticism far more often than we should. Satan will use criticism to drag us down. Satan knows it's a weakness of most of us, and so he'll use that to kind of drag us down and bring us down. Nothing can hurt more than being criticized by a spouse, a family member, someone you love, people that you trust. When they criticize you and you didn't know it, or they were doing it behind your back, those types of things hurt. The question is, how do we as a child of God, as a believer, handle criticism? Well, Nehemiah chapter 4 is really about an unfortunate but inevitable component of leadership. And that is criticism and opposition. I think a couple weeks ago I asked the question if you had any enemies, and as you were going out, some of you made the statement that so many people make. No, I really don't think I have any enemies. And I just smiled because I know that that's probably not true. We all have people that criticize us and oppose us on some level. We are going to face criticism. Can we just agree right there this morning as we begin? We're going to face criticism. Try to do something good. There's always going to be somebody there to point out the bad that you did or how you did not do it well enough. In fact, I would say this. If you are not enduring criticism today, check your pulse, because of a good chance you're not living. Criticism is real. Elder Hubbard made this statement. He said, to avoid criticism, do nothing, say nothing, and be nothing. Is that a good point? If you want to avoid criticism, say nothing, do nothing, and be nothing. Well, this morning, I want to spend just a minute looking at Nehemiah's critics. Now, one thing that's interesting to me is this. We're looking at a time frame of about 2,500 years ago, somewhere in that time frame. And in spite of that, critics have not changed. You would think human history would learn over time, right? That we should not be so critical, but the truth is that's not the case. Look at verse 1 of chapter 4, if you would, because I want you to see what these critics of Nehemiah did. In Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 1, it says, when Sanballat heard that they were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly infused, is the word that is used there. Now, you know about this character, Sanballat, because we first met him in chapter 2. And Nehemiah's response to him then was, look, it's really just none of your business. So here's the story again. If you haven't got it already, Nehemiah gets this. He wants to build this wall to protect his people. Sanballat has something negative to say about it. Nehemiah basically says, look, it's none of your business. But like all critics, he doesn't stop talking trash. Now, I don't need to go into detail on what talking trash is, right? You're all familiar with that. See. This is an individual, Sanballat, that did exactly that. Look at verse 2 of chapter 4. It says that he ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, who are these feeble Jews? What are they doing? Now, this is typical of a critic. If you notice the phrase, in the presence of his associates. Because critics always are looking for an audience. I know not all of you are up on social media, is what it's called today, but for those of you that are on social media, you can realize this is a very real thing, even in the life of a Christian. I have had to literally bite my tongue and just not say nothing and keep all my posts positive, because there's so many things that I could be critical about what someone else is saying, but I don't want it to ruin my testimony. Not saying I haven't done it before, just throw that disclaimer out there. But for the most part, I've come to realize that a critic is just wanting an audience. They're wanting to build this audience, and they're wanting people to jump on board with them. You know what you do whenever you have someone like that? When someone starts criticizing someone else in your presence, and it really doesn't involve you, you do not become the audience. And this is a lesson that Nehemiah gives us. You don't become the audience for the critic. Notice verse 3, if you would. It says, in chapter 4, verse 3, Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, what are they building? And then he says it like this. Even if a little fox stood up on top of that wall that they're building, it would fall. And so he joins in the criticism of the crowd. Now, to paint the picture, what they're doing is Nehemiah and his people are building this wall to protect their people, to restore their dignity. And these other individuals are building an army up to criticize them. And one of them lashes out and says, that thing wouldn't even hold up a fox. And so the crowd just joins in. Now look at verse 8, if you would. It says, they all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against them. The interesting word there is to fight against. Because that's what a person that is critical likes to do. They like to fight. Now I wish the world was not this way, but folks, you're going to have to understand there are going to be people in your family that are your blood kin that like to do nothing more than fight. That's just who they are. That's like to do. They like to stir up trouble. They're always critical of everything, and you're never going to make them happy. And that is also true of people that you work with, and unfortunately, it can be true of people that you worship with at times. That's what critics like to do. They're not really accomplishing anything. They just like to create problems. Now, there's not a doubt in my mind that we could spend the rest of the afternoon and I could say, give me a name, and I could start right here, and we could go around the room, and we'd have a list of names of people that I just described, that you live with, that you work with, that you're related to. Well, things get worse. In fact, look at verse 11 and notice how things begin to intensify. It says, and our adversary said, they shall not know, neither see, till we come in and mix among them and slay them and cause the work to cease. Now this has taken a whole new level. We're going to talk about this in a minute. But now the critics have decided they're going to do everything within their power to make sure that Nehemiah and his people do not succeed. Now we know that Nehemiah took this seriously. And he took the steps that he needed to protect his project and his people. But we have to understand something. Here is a key characteristic about a critic. All they really want to do is intimidate. That's the goal. That's what Sanballat was doing. He wanted to intimidate Nehemiah. It is a tool that Satan will use in your life, is to find someone in your life that can intimidate you, that you're not comfortable being around. And when you try to do something good, they're going to be there to mock you, to ridicule you. They'll be skeptical. They'll be condescending. And sometimes they'll just outright oppose whatever it is that you're trying to do. Well, that's the background for the message today, but here's the real question. How do you and I, as a believer, as a child of God, how do we respond to criticism? There's a right way and there's a wrong way. And I've already shared with you, criticism, when I'm criticized, it makes me want to react, and not always in a positive way. So I'm speaking today from not only experience, but more importantly, I'm speaking today from how Scripture teaches us to handle criticism. Five things, quickly, I'm going to share with you that we see in the way that Nehemiah handled his critics. Number one, and this seems to be the most simple, is just to keep praying about it. Well, you say, well, that's awful easy. I mean, is that really all that we need to do? Well, we see this again and again throughout the book of Nehemiah. When Sanballat and Tobiah began their attack, what was Nehemiah's first response? We find his response in verses 4 and 5, and I want to read them to you. He prays, and he says, hear, O God, for we are despised, and turn their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity. Now, that may not mean a lot to you right now, but let me kind of translate what Nehemiah just said there. God, we are your people. We really don't want them around. Do whatever it takes to get rid of them. In fact, we don't care if the birds of the air eat their dead carcass. Now, you read what I just said, and basically, Nehemiah is being transparent, and he's sharing his heart, and that's his prayer. It may not be a theological prayer, theological appropriate prayer, but that's what was on his heart at that time. He was tired of being criticized. And he says, God, do not let these enemies destroy us or to destroy the work that we're doing. We see that again in verse 9. So here's what I'm challenging you to do. When you have a critic in your life, which you are going to have, you must pray for that individual. You have no choice. Scripture teaches us that. In the New Testament, we see that. Jesus said, pray for those that despise you. Well, that's hard to do, but we see Nehemiah doing this as well. So, the first thing we do is we keep praying about it. Here's the second thing we need to do, and we see Nehemiah doing this. This is a long one. But don't lose sight of the job you have been called to do. Go back to chapter 1. What was the job Nehemiah felt God was leading him to do? It was build the wall. What does Satan always do in our life? He distracts us from God's original plan for our life. Satan always has distractions that lay ahead. Satan will always have a critic that is there to let you know you're not doing it the way that you're supposed to be doing it. Now, most of you in this room have had children and you have raised children. And no doubt you have had someone criticize you about the way that you have raised your children. And generally, it's people that have children that are just off the hook. I mean, they're off the wall, and you're thinking, who are they to give me advice about raising my own kids? Oh, by the way, that's the other thing that really gets under my skin, is when people criticize my kids. Like, there's two things in life I really think I would fight over and die over, and that's my wife and my kids. If they criticize them, now, I can talk about my kids. I know they're heathens. I don't have a problem with that. From the 22-year-old down to the 7-year-old, they're all heathens. I've accepted that. But does it not do something to you? And if Satan knows how sensitive we are, that when somebody else said, oh, I can't believe your child would do that. Man, you just know what you want to do, right? Exactly that's what you want to do. Well, what they're saying may be true. They're just being critical. But here's the point to remember. The point to remember is Satan wants you to fall. Satan wants you to ruin your testimony. Your children are not going to be perfect. Listen, your grandchildren are not going to be perfect. Some of you have children that are my age, and they're still not perfect. They're still disappointing you. And Satan's going to look at you, and he's going to say, what kind of a parent are you? Here you are sitting in church, and look at the stuff that your children are doing. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Satan's the greatest critic that has ever been around, that will ever be around. He's the greatest. You know what we need to do? Don't lose sight of the job you have been called to do. I want you to notice that Nehemiah didn't say anything to Sanballat or Tobiah. He didn't defend his strategy when they were criticizing him. He didn't say, oh yeah, but wait, if you only knew the big picture here. He didn't even argue with them. In fact, he didn't do what I would have done. Had they said to me, listen, this wall you're building right here, a fox stood on, if a fox stands on that thing, it's going to fall down. You know what I would have done? I'd have brought a whole herd of those things in, and I had them all standing up there, and I said, see, this thing can hold all these foxes. Damn, I didn't do that. He didn't try to prove his point. He didn't counterattack. He didn't start calling names. What did Nehemiah do, and what did he lead his people to do? He just kept working towards what he knew God wanted him to do. He was willing. He prayed about it already. And now he's staying focused. Now let me make a very important statement this morning. When you hear criticism about things in your life, do not lose sight of what you're supposed to be doing. It's the way Satan will get you sidetracked in your marriage, raising your children, with your job. Satan can make you feel as though you are absolutely worthless as a Christian. We've all been there. That we're not where we're supposed to be, and we're never going to get to where we're supposed to be. And Satan becomes that critic in our life. You know what we have to do? We have to remind Satan, listen, I'm not going to listen to you. Criticize me all that you want. God has given me a job to do, and I am going to do it. Keep building that wall, whatever it is, in your life. Now here's a third way to respond to criticism. Nehemiah prayed about it. Secondly, he didn't lose sight of the job that he was called to do. But I want you to notice this third thing. He kept his guard up. Folks, we need to hear this today. Just because we're a Christian does not mean we sweep everything under the rug. Just because we are Christians does not mean we become a doormat. Amen. And I want you to understand that there is a difference between responding to a threat and responding to criticism. Responding to criticism, which amounts to a little more than just arguing, is of no use at all. It will not make you feel better. It will not solve anything. Responding to a threat is absolutely necessary. God expects you to protect yourself. Amen. But God does not expect you to respond to every little critic that is out there that is saying something bad about you. You must protect yourself. Nehemiah did this. He didn't respond to the criticism. But when it turned to threats there in that passage that we read, what did he do in verse 9? He says, we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet the threat. Christians can make the mistake sometimes and say, well, God's just going to take care of me. I'm not going to worry about this. You know, God's just going to take care of me and let somebody beat the pulp out of them. Listen, you have a right to protect yourself, and you should. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you just sit there and do absolutely nothing to protect yourself. Again in verse 13, he says, "Therefore I stationed some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall, at all the exposed places." What's he doing? He's protecting himself. He's not going on the offense, but he is taking the necessary steps that he needs to. This is a lesson that we as Christians need to learn. And I say this, this needs to be said. There are certain people in your life that have gone beyond being critical of you. They are damaging you emotionally. And there are times in your life where the Christian thing to do is just to not deal with them anymore, not allow them to be part of your life. Remember, you're not a doormat just because you're a Christian. And people will say, "Well, but how do I show them the love of Christ?" Listen, there are people in your life you have to take a personal inventory and say, is it worth my spiritual health and my mental health to allow them to be in my life? And that is a choice that you have. I have found that there are some steps that we can take to protect ourselves when we're being attacked and people are being critical of us. And I've had to do this in leadership often and still do it to this day. I've been in situations where people have twisted my words and they'll repeat something that I said, but they twist it and I find myself saying, "I never said that." So you know what I do in a situation like that? This is a good practice. Put it in writing. You can't twist it if it's in writing, right?
Right.
Sometimes you will have to do that with your family members. It's just the way that it is. Sometimes I'll follow up with an email and say, "Oh, just want to follow up on the conversation we had," and then list it out. That way there's no miscommunication there. I think that's biblical. I think it's what Paul talks about in 1 Thessalonians 5:22 when he said, "Abstain from all appearances of evil." There will be evil people in your life, evil influences in your life, and you have to protect yourself just like Nehemiah did in those situations. Now, isn't it unfortunate that we have to live that way?
Yes.
But folks, we can pretend the world is not that way and live in our little bubble, but that is just not reality. We have to protect ourselves. And Nehemiah said this in verse 17. I want you to mark this. He said, "Those who carried materials did their work with one hand and held a weapon with the other hand." That's not politically correct, I can promise you that. He was saying they went about doing their work. They were trusting God, but they were going to protect themselves. Nothing wrong with that. He also said, "We never let down our guard." So how is he responding to criticism up to this point? He prayed about it. He didn't lose sight of what he was supposed to do. He kept up his guard. Here's a fourth thing. This is very important when we're dealing with critics. And that is, keep spending time with the right people. Nehemiah had good people around him. He had godly people around him. We need to make sure that we have those individuals in our life as well. Individuals that have been through this type of criticism. Others that are more spiritually mature than us. Let me just throw this plug out there. This is the reason why you need to get plugged into a good Bible study, a good Sunday school class, because it's groups like that that can help you through situations like this in your life.
Amen.
You know, a lot of what we do here, like a Sunday school class or a Bible study, it's not just about going through a lesson and saying, "Oh, we've studied that lesson." We are real people with real hurts and real problems that need to be able to share that with other people that's been down that road already. So when the critics come, we can help one another. That's the fourth thing. Keep spending time with the right people. Take an evaluation of your life. Do you have those individuals in your life? If not, you need to get some. Finally this morning, one last thing that we see Nehemiah doing. Now let me go over these one more time. He prayed about it. He didn't lose sight of what God had called him to do. He kept up his guard. He was protecting himself. He surrounded himself with good people. But then finally, he kept reminding himself of what was really important. Folks, when the threats reached their peak in Nehemiah's life, I want you to look at what he said in verse 14. He said, "I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome and fight for us, will fight for you." That's keeping focused on what God has called you to do. Nehemiah was saying, remember the Lord. Remember who we're serving. Remember who it is that protects us. I can speak from experience. I've had to do that. I've had to realize at times that, why do I do what I do? I'm doing it for the honor and the glory of God. We all have to make that decision in our life. We have to remember that our ultimate goal is serving God. I don't know who came up with this quote, but boy, I sure did like it. Someone said one time, they said, critics are like gnats. On a hot day, or on a beautiful day, they're always around. Isn't that true? And they concluded that by saying, and despite the weather, they're always annoying. There's truth to that. Because gnats are always there. They're always there. They're always annoying. But the same thing is true with critics. Doesn't matter how much spiritual achievement success you achieve in your life, you're always going to have a critic in your life. They're going to criticize your marriage. They're going to criticize your children. They're going to criticize you and the way you raise your children. They're going to criticize you as a grandparent. They're going to criticize you as a co-worker. You know what we need to remember? We're only here for a short, limited time. We need to just do our best. So let's be like Nehemiah. When critics come in our life, and I want you to think about who that critic is in your life. We all have them. I want you to keep praying about it, just like Nehemiah. Don't lose sight of what God is wanting you to do. Keep your guard up. Don't be a doormat. Make sure the right people are around you that can give you godly advice. And then keep reminding yourself why you do the things that you do. You don't want to ruin your Christian testimony over some critic that does not like you anyways. Would that be worth losing your testimony over? This one person that's always criticizing you? No. Keep focused, like the Apostle Paul, on the prize. We all have critics. There's a right way and there's a wrong way to handle it. Nehemiah has given us the right way. Let's follow his example. Would you stand with me? Father, we thank you today, once again, that we have this opportunity to stand here in your presence and in your house. Lord, I pray that this message today would be very practical and close to us. I pray that this would be a message, Lord, that we would all take to heart and that we would realize that, God, every single person that is seated here today has a critic. God, I am asking you to help us not only to be able to identify that, but Lord, help us to make sure that we do our part as well. And don't respond to their criticism. Don't allow it to drag us down. Lord, I pray today that you would help us to be more mature than that you would help us to be stronger than that. But God, I also realize that criticism hurts, and it causes deep wounds in our life. So, Lord, there may be some people today in our life that we need to forgive just because of who they are. Doesn't mean we have to associate with them, but we need to forgive them so that we can go on with our own life, not allow it to drag us down. God, that's hurtful as well, because people that we love, we don't expect to hurt us, but many times they will, and that's part of life because of our sinful human flesh. Lord, help us today identify those critics. Help us to pray for them. Help us to take the right step to protect ourselves. And help us to stay focused on what you have called us to do. Lord, help us not to ruin our testimony as the result of someone else's life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you this morning, as we sing our invitation hymn, if you need to come. This altar is always open. I invite you to do that.